All right, there we go. Okay. So let's move on. So, like I said last week, or like I alluded to last week, when we have a metabolic acidosis, okay, so if we identify that our patient has a metabolic acidosis, we need to realize that there are two forms of metabolic acidosis. Okay? So there are two forms. And each form has different causes. That's why it's important to understand that there are two forms. So the first form of metabolic acidosis is something called hyperchloremic. Hyperchloremic or non-elevated anion gap. Okay. Those mean the same thing. Okay. So hyperchloremic or non-elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis. Okay, so that's one form. The other form of metabolic acidosis is elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis. All right, so these are the two forms, or you can look at them as types of metabolic acidosis. You guys okay so far? I do not know that this is discussed in the textbook. I don't think it is. Which is too bad, because it is a fairly important thing to understand. Okay. In fact, it's so important that when I was in grad school, I did some of my research revolved around the anion gap and using it to identify certain problems, which we'll talk about today. Okay. So let's talk about the anion gap, what it is, first of all, before we go into elevated and non-elevated. Okay. So when you look at the blood, we look at blood plasma, we draw a sample of blood plasma, and we run what's known as a chemistry on that. It's a type of lab test. And the chemistry looks at your various electrolytes, okay, among other things, but the things that we're concerned about are the electrolytes. Okay? And those electrolytes can either be cations or anions, right? What's that? Yep, so the cations are positively charged. They're metals that have lost electrons, and the anions are negatively charged, that tend to be non-metals that gain electrons. We talked about that in chemistry already. So, what do you suppose the overall charge in your blood plasma is? Think we're a little more positively charged inside, or negatively charged, or what do you guys think? Well, if I was charged, what would that mean? If I had like a positive or negative charge in me, what would that mean? Yeah, what would that mean if I touched something?
Shocking.
Yeah, right? Right, you guys have all had static electricity, right? You've had an excess, or you've had either too many or too few electrons, and then when you touch something, right, what happens? Everything equals out, right? And you get that shock because you have electrons moving either away from your body or to your body. So everything wants to do what? Even out, right? So the net charge in your body is actually neutral. There is no net charge. So what that means is, if I take all of the positively charged particles in your plasma, right, and I take all the negatively charged particles in your plasma, what should happen? They should equal out, right? The positives should equal the negatives, and the net charge would be zero. Does that kind of make sense? That is what the anion gap is. What we do to calculate the anion gap is we take and we find the positives, okay, the cations, and we subtract from those cations the negatives, or the anions. Okay? That's easier said than done because there are lots of them. So what we do is we simplify it and we say, well, what are the major cations in the body? What are the major positively charged particles in your blood plasma?
Potassium.
Okay, potassium is one of them.
Sodium.
Good. Sodium and potassium, right, are your major positives. And then you have just a tiny, tiny, minuscule amount of things like calcium and magnesium. But the concentrations are so small that we really don't account. We don't account for them. So it's sodium and potassium. Okay. What do you suppose the major anions are going to be?
Chloride.
Chloride is going to be the most abundant. Chloride. What else?
Phosphate.
Phosphate, tiny amount. Tiny amount of phosphate, but you're absolutely right, it is an anion. Chloride and what else is a major anion? It's actually part of your blood buffer. Bicarbonate, right? Yeah, bicarbonate. Yeah. Okay, you guys good with that? So what we do is we take the sum of all the positives and subtract from that the sum of all the negatives. Okay, so let's say that I have a patient with the following labs. They have a sodium of 135. Okay. They have a potassium of 4. Okay. They have a chloride of 110 and a bicarbonate. Of let's do 24. Okay. All right. So first thing I do is I add my positives up. What's 135 plus 4? That's 139. Okay. So all my positives are 139, right? And then I subtract from that the sum of my negatives. What's 110 plus 24?
134.
134, okay, good. So 134 subtract 139 is?
5.
And that is my anion gap. So in this particular patient, their anion gap would be 5 milliequivalents per liter. Okay, now, remember how I said there were other negatively charged things in your body, such as phosphate, let's see, another one is albumin, a protein in your blood, but we don't measure those other things, right? Those are not commonly measured. Those are what we call unmeasured anions. And because there are some negatives that we don't measure, we have to take that into consideration. And so in a patient with a normal anion gap, that gap is caused by those other negatively charged particles that we haven't measured. Well, that's nice, but what's a normal anion gap?
5 to 15.
Yeah, so 5 to 15, 4 to 12, some people will say. It varies a little bit. We can go to 5 to 15 milliequivalents per liter. What's important for us is this 15 here. If you calculate the anion gap and it's greater than 15, okay, that means your patient has an elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis. So far, so good? Is that making sense?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the next question is, well, what?
Can you repeat the last part one more time?
I'm sorry, what?
Can you repeat the last part one more time?
Sure. So when you calculate the anion gap, as we just did here, right? We got 5 for this patient, right, which is normal. If you calculate anion gap, and it is greater than 15, okay? And it varies a little bit from lab to lab, but greater than 15 is good enough for us. That indicates that they have an elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis. Does that kind of make sense?
Mm-hmm.
So, everybody's okay there? Sorry. So if the anion gap's greater than 15, it's elevated. That's what we would consider elevated. All right, you guys cool with that? So the next thing that I want to ask, question I want to ask is, well, what does that mean? What does it mean to have an elevated anion gap? Well, it means that you have a large concentration of a negatively charged particle in your body that's not being measured, right? You have a mystery meat floating around, an unmeasured anion. Yes. All right, so in anion gap, in elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis, this is what happens. We get what are known as organic acids. Organic acids. When organic acids are produced or added to the body, they do something interesting. They do something interesting. And what I want to do is I want to take an example of a very common, what do you suppose a very common organic acid would be? When we talk about acidosis and organic acids, what do you think are common? What if I go into shock? What are my cells producing when I go into shock?
Lactic acid.
Lactic acid, perfect. That's a perfect, good example. Everybody knows what lactic acid is. So lactic acid, lactic acid has the following formula, CH3CHOHCO2H. All right, so there you go. So when lactic acid is introduced into the body, remember, what is an acid? It donates, good, donates protons, okay? So when lactic acid gets dissolved in your plasma, it does what acids do, okay? It gives up its hydrogen ion. So it gives off an H plus. You guys see that there?
Is that an H on the end?
Yeah, that's an H on the end there. Yeah, so it gives off an H plus. So what is left behind is another molecule, right? If a proton is given off, then the molecule that's left over must be what kind of charge?
Negative.
Must have a negative charge, right? Does that make sense? If it gives off a positive, then
it's got to be boys.
Yeah. So what's left behind is a molecule CH3CHOHCO2, but it has a negative charge, right? It gave up that hydrogen ion, that proton. Okay? And this here, right, is the anion, right? This is an anion.
Because it's not fully negative charged.
What's that?
Because it's negative charged.
Negatively charged, right? So the lactic acid broke down into this molecule and a proton. Does that make sense? Because that's what acids do, right? They give off protons. They donate protons. When an acid does that, when an organic acid does that, we change its name. So lactic acid is called lactate. Lactate is the anion that's left over when lactic acid donates a proton. Does that make sense? So lactic acid becomes lactate. L-A-C-T-A-T-E, lactate. So citric acid would become citrate. Does that make sense?
No.
Okay?
Yeah, no, it's making sense.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I'm just kind of walking you guys through, kind of just walking through what's going on here. Okay, so You guys good with that? So, remember, I have bicarbonate floating around in the blood as well, right? And what does the bicarbonate do?
It's a buffer.
It buffers these hydrogen ions, right? So these hydrogen ions get associated with bicarbonate to produce carbonic acid, right? Which turns into carbon dioxide and water, right? That's how we buffer these protons. Does that make sense? So what happens is you start using up your bicarbonate, right? Your bicarbonate gets used up, right? So you're losing bicarbonate, your bicarbonate levels decrease, and the level of lactate in this case increases, right? Well, here's a question. Do we measure the lactate level, though? Is that something that's commonly measured in the anion gap calculation? What do you think? No. So what's going to happen is your bicarbonate is going to get low, right? Because these protons are using the bicarbonate up. So your bicarbonate is going to get low, and you're going to have all this lactate floating around that's not measured. So what's going to happen is you're going to have something like this. So let's say that I have my normal healthy person here. They have a sodium of 135, potassium of 4, a chloride of 110, and a bicarbonate of 24. So sodium, potassium, chloride, and bicarbonate. Okay? So that's a normal, healthy person. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put that person into shock, and I'm going to give them lactic acidosis. And I'm going to assume that the sodium potassium don't change much, even though they actually might a little bit, but we'll keep them the same. So that's 135, that's 4, okay? Chloride's not going to change, but what's going to happen to the bicarbonate? It's going to decrease, right? Because the hydrogen ions are using it up. So let's say that the bicarbonate becomes 12, gets really low. You guys cool with that? So let's now redo the anion gap. So we know that the anion gap here is 5, right? Let's figure out what the anion gap is in this situation. So 135 plus 4 is
139.
What's 100 plus 12? 112. So what's 139 minus 19? It's 727, right? You guys see what happened there? See how large that anion gap is here in this patient with
elevated anion gap?
Yeah, with lactic acidosis. What's causing this to be elevated? That 27 is this lactate molecule floating around, right? Does that make sense?
Sort of.
Yes, you guys okay with that? All right. And I don't know, I'm kind of getting some this and that. So all of this lactate here, right? All of this lactate. All this lactate here, this increase in lactate, is unmeasured, right? It's an unmeasured anion. And so that's what's causing this to be so high. Now, it doesn't always lactate, okay? There are some other organic acids that can cause this. Lactic acid is one of them. It's one of the primary causes. Lactic acid is one of them, okay? Another one are keto acids. Yeah. So an increase in keto acids, like beta hydroxybutyrate and others, right, We see those in DKA, right? Diabetic ketoacidosis. So keto acids will do that as well. Formic acid comes from a toxic alcohol known as methanol. Methanol. So if somebody drank methanol, that methanol would get metabolized into formic acid. The formic acid would break down into formate and protons, and it would be the formate ions that would cause the anion gap to elevate. Another one is oxalic acid. Oxalic acid, and that's caused by another toxic alcohol known as ethylene glycol. Does anyone happen to know where ethylene glycol is commonly found?
Antifreeze.
Antifreeze, yeah, it's a component of antifreeze.
Huh?
You
know what it is. We knew that one.
Ethylene what?
Glycol.
Yeah, ethylene glycol. Antifreeze, yep. Good deal. And then salicylic acid as well. Where does salicylic acid commonly come from?
Aspirin is
acetyl salicylic acid, yeah, ASA, right? And salicylic acid becomes salicylate. Right? Oxalic acid become oxalate. Formic acid become formate. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So all of these organic acids, when produced or added to the body, break down to anions that elevate the anion gap. You guys okay with that? Yeah.
No.
Sure?
Yeah.
Okay. Does that sort of make sense? That unmeasured anions, okay, as they increase, they drop the bicarb down, right? Bicarb decreases, and then all these negative anions are produced, right? And they cause that gap to become large. So now let's move over to hyperchloremic or non-elevated ionic gap. Okay. So we talked about elevated anion gap already. Let's now talk about hyperchloremic or non-elevated anion gap acidosis. Okay. So, in non-elevated anion gap acidosis, what happens is a little different. Organic acids aren't being produced. In non-elevated anion gap acidosis, what happens is your bicarb gets used up or eliminated. Your bicarbonate gets used up or eliminated. So let's say that I've got my normal person 135 for the sodium. The potassium is 4. The chloride is 110. And the bicarbonate is 24. Okay? So that gives us that 5 again, right? Now, instead of giving this patient an anion gap, instead of giving lactic acidosis, what I'm going to do instead is I'm going to give them a serious case of diarrhea. Lots of diarrhea. So what's going to happen with lots of diarrhea?
Dump the potassium.
You might dump some potassium. What else is going to happen? There you go, base. I just remember base you lose out of your butt. Base out of your butt, right? Because remember, your stomach contains a lot of acid, right? Hydrochloric acid. And then that acid is dumped into your small intestines. And to neutralize that acid, the pancreas secretes large amounts of bicarb in there, right? And so what happens is you have a lot of bicarbonate in there. And if you have diarrhea that flushes all that away before that bicarbonate can get reabsorbed, right, you're going to lose that bicarbonate. Does that kind of make sense there? So you lose base out of your butt. Just think of that. So I'm going to give this patient a lot of diarrhea. And so their sodium is not really going to change much. Their potassium, we'll say in this case, won't really change much. I'll come back to their chloride. But what's going to happen to their bicarbonate? What's that?
It decreases.
It decreases, right? They're going to poop. They're pooping all their bicarbonate out. They're losing it, right? They're actively losing their bicarbonate. And so let's say that they drops it, their bicarbonate down to 12. You guys okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
But here's the problem. I've lost a whole bunch of negative charge, right? Bicarbonate is negatively charged. So what do you suppose has to happen to offset that loss of negative charge? Not a positive. I need some other negative charge to come in and take the place. So yeah, the chloride will shift out of the cells. That's known as the chloride shift or the hamburger effect. So chloride will shift out of the cells, right, to come in and maintain electroneutrality. So if I went from 24 milliequivalents per liter of bicarbonate to 12, how many milliequivalents did I lose? I lost 12, right? So what's going to happen to my chloride? My chloride's going to have to increase by 12, right? So 110 plus 12 is 122, right? Right? Are you guys okay with why the chloride had to increase? Because I lost a negative. I've lost an anion here, right?
Is it how much bicarbonate you lose?
Yep. Yeah. So I lose a bunch of bicarbonate, right? So chloride shifts out of the cells into the plasma to fill in the gap where that negative or an anion is needed. See, that doesn't happen here in elevated anion gap acidosis because you have an anion that's already being made here, right? So the chloride doesn't need to shift here because this anion's already being produced. But here, because you're losing bicarbonate without making some anion, chloride needs to shift out of the cells. Does that kind of make sense there? Okay. So let's now calculate. So we said the anion gap here was 5. Well, let's just calculate it here. So what's 135 plus 4? It's 139. What's 122 plus 12? 134. So the anion gap remains. Look at that. Yeah, it is non-elevated, but the chloride increased. And that's why this is sometimes known as hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis is also known as non-elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis. Does that make sense, what's going on there?
Yes.
That's why I wanted to talk about these two different types of acidosis because they have different causes. Okay. Now, there is another cause for hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Large amounts of diarrhea is one major cause. Another major cause involves a dysfunction of the kidneys. The specific dysfunction is acute tubular necrosis, or ATN. All right, acute tubular necrosis. So it's necrosis of the urinary tubules. And so what happens is the kidney is unable to hold on to bicarbonate ions. It's unable to reabsorb them back into the body, so they just get lost in the urine. They just pee them right off. It can't hold on to them. So patients that have renal damage, kidney damage, that go on to develop acute tubular necrosis are going to be much more prone to an elevated anion gap, or non-elevated, or hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. Does that kind of make sense?
Yes.
So, non-elevated or hypochloremic metabolic acidosis is due to a loss of bicarbonate, right? And chloride shifts in, right? And it's typically some sort of renal problem or lots of diarrhea. Whereas an elevated anion gap acidosis is due to the presence of an organic acid that adds ions, right? And there is no chloride shift there, right? It's just a decreased bicarb without a chloride shift because you've got this anion being created in the background, right? You guys cool with that? So, when you do your ABG interpretation, all right, if you have a blood chemistry available, you then need to say if the patient's acidotic, if they have a metabolic acidosis, and you have a blood chemistry, you need to go, is this hyperchloremic or is this elevated anion gap acidosis? And the way that you do that is you just pull up their sodium, their potassium, their chloride, and their bicarb, and you calculate their anion gap. If it's elevated, you know it's an elevated. If it's normal or low, then you know it's hyperchloremic. And if it is elevated, there is a saying that can, there's a mnemonic that can really help. And that mnemonic, I'll write it over here since I'm out of space on the board, is mud piles. Mud piles is that mnemonic. These are our common causes of an elevated anion gap acidosis. So M is methanol. U is uremia. What does uremia mean? You guys ever heard that term, uremia? Uremia literally means urine in the blood, right? So it's renal failure, it's kidney failure, is what uremia is. D is DKA, diabetic ketoacidosis. P is pyraldehyde. You don't see this as much anymore. It sometimes uses a preservative in some drugs. It's a fairly rare thing. I is INH, which is an anti-tuberculosis drug. Okay. L is lactic acidosis. Okay. E is ethylene glycol. And then S are the salicylates. You guys okay with that? So methanol, uremia, diabetic ketoacidosis, pyraldehyde, INH, lactic acidosis, ethylene glycol, salicylates, and then some people also add, under the M, another common medication, metformin. Does anyone know what metformin is? Huh? Yes, it's glucophage, is the trait.
What is this?
Huh?
What is this for?
This is a mnemonic to help you memorize the causes of a elevated anion gap acidosis.
So common.
Yeah. Mud piles are, this is a standard mnemonic. An elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis. Yeah. Think of mud piles. These are the things you want to think about. In fact, metformin is such a problem. This is something that you guys, when you were doing your clinical rotations, if you're taking care of patients in the emergency room, this is something that's really important for you guys. If that patient is on metformin, they cannot have a CT scan with contrast. This is why. They have to be off of contrast for at least 24 to 48 hours. IV contrast, at least, before they... If they get contrast with metformin, that can cause a significant, deadly, elevated anion gap metabolic acidosis. So that's one of the things we need to be asking people. If you know they're going to CT, hey, oh, I see you're on a metformin glucophage. Do did you take it today? Oh, you did? Then you need to, you know, get with the doc, get with x-ray and say, hey. Now, x-ray is supposed to have a checklist that they go through before they do this contrast studies, and they're supposed to ask these questions, but stuff slips through cracks, and you know, you guys know very well, save the day there. That kind of makes sense? Okay, how about we take a break? There's a lot of stuff to go over. I'll see you guys in about 15 minutes.